Hey, welcome to Speechless. Glad to have you here this Thursday night. We're live from the SCC studios in White Bear Lake, also playing live out of St. Paul, SPNN. And tonight's show, kind of the philosophy of governing in one sense, but with real stories happening to real people, and the attack on our Constitution, the attack on religious liberties, and it happens in so many ways and from so many angles. So you may not notice what will look like something else is happening, and you can't tie that into a religious liberty issue. But if it happens over here, the religious liberty gets affected. And I'm not talking about religious liberties where you have your ideas and you have your beliefs, but keep them to yourself. I'm talking about where you get to practice what you believe. You get to put into effect your faith and your religious freedom. It's not a thing where you can go to church and worship and then have your personal opinions. You know, I'm talking about you get to play out your personal opinions based on freedom of religion. And when you hear the silencing of free speech by liberals, they're forcing people not to be able to talk about topics they don't agree with. And so that's the bottom line. So when you hear city council members, legislature, Supreme Court justices say, we got to limit your speech, or we got to tell you what you can say and what you can't say, or the country as a whole says what you can say and can't say, your religious freedoms are being attacked, even though it doesn't look like it. And all your other liberties are being attacked, because if you take away some of these liberties, and that's why our founding fathers made them so intertwined, that freedom of speech is meaningless without the right to bear arms. The right to bear arms is meaningless without freedom of speech. So is the freedom of the press. They're all meaningless if they're pulled apart and you don't get one of those. The right to peacefully assemble. Okay, there is no right to unpeacefully assemble, which people think that there is this right that you can get together and then be destructive in an assembly. You can't, okay? It's peacefully assemble. And a number of liberal people are starting to talk about how the left is killing free speech, and actually Kirsten Powers wrote a book on it, The Silencing, How the Left is Killing Free Speech. So, and you're going to see it, and you are seeing it in your local communities. And you hear the conversation, and it is a righteous conversation that is taking place. It is, you hear them talk and banter and back and forth, and they're just going, we are so cool. We are so right on. We are so righteous speaking about not letting you say what you want to say. And you get up there and say it, but it's wrong, so therefore we can't let you say it. That's what we're going to talk about today and what's going on. But before we get into that, just a little announcement. Next week, starting July 20th and runs through July 26th, is National Parental Rights Week. Okay. National Parental Rights Week. And parentalrights.org is educating people on this. Of course, they're pushing for a parental rights amendment to the Constitution. Unfortunately, in a Supreme Court decision, Troxel v. versus Granville, Supreme Court put our parental rights in danger. Didn't totally eliminate them, but put them in danger to be eliminated through a treaty, through other acts of Congress. And that's why we need to have a U.S. constitutional amendment that says parental rights, you have a right as a parent to raise your children in the education and upbringing your choice. And it's more elaborate than that. It's basically saying, hey, state, you want to take away my parental rights to raise my kids the way I want to raise them? You got to have a criminal act. You have to have a force of law. You have to have it spelled out. You can't just go up and show up as a social worker and say, somebody said you're feeding your kids hot dogs. You know, you're a bad parent. We're going to arrest you or take your kids from you. Or you better agree to go to counseling right away or we'll take them and until you get your counseling done. That's, you know, our state is doing that type of thing. So go to parentalrights.org and find out about the Parental Rights Constitutional Amendment. And why it's important that we do it now is because the majority of the people would be in favor of that. And why you wouldn't do it now is because you wouldn't be in favor of that. And the objection would be, oh, but there isn't a need. Well, you know, it's the same thing for marriage. Marriage, one man, one woman. We never put it into the Constitution because who would think that marriage would be anything different? And so now the time to go and put it in to the Constitution may be too late, or it may have just started the uproar that we need to go and put this into our U.S. Constitution. Well, we need to put parental rights now into the U.S. Constitution, and that's in order to protect them. However, the big fight is people don't think it's a problem, but neither was this heterosexual marriage, marriage between a man and woman. That was not put into jeopardy until the U.S. Supreme Court totally went bonkers, at least five of the lawyers did. So, all right, so that's the announcement. Parental Rights Week, next week, 20th to the 26th. Okay, it's interesting. I heard this story this last week where somebody was looking to rent a room in a house, and they had emailed the person, said they were interested, and gave a little background. And now the advertisement for the room said, welcome anybody, whether they're male, female, gay or straight. You know, the room's available, and something to that effect. And then this person contacted the person, said, they're interested in the room, and got no response, and then emailed again, said, hey, they're interested in the room, and then finally got a response back stating that they had seen on the internet that the individual was bashing Democrats, so therefore that person couldn't have the room. So that person be sued, you know, for political party discrimination. Also, what that individual didn't know, and I know this individual that was applying for the room, they also bash Republicans. And they bash libertarians. And they also say good things about Democrats, and they also say bad things about Democrats. So, or about bad things about Republicans. So, what you also find out is, you know, now personally, where I'm at on this deal is this individual's home. It's not a duplex where there's a separate wall, separate entrance. It's their home, so I think they should have full. They can discriminate however they want, in my opinion, as far as who gets to rent from them, and because they're sharing space and stuff like that. I don't have any problem with that. But however, what you would find out is that a liberal would sue. You're not going to let me rent a room because I'm a Democrat. You know, I'm suing, you know, whether it's a private home or not. And they probably don't have good, they probably have good grounds to go for that lawsuit. I don't know. I would hope not, you know. But anyway, liberals, though, go looking, and the gay community, I don't want to say gay, the lesbian, the homosexual community, they go looking for such lawsuits. And of course, they had no problem going after the baker, the florists, all kinds of people who were trying to force people with religious convictions to perform and engage in a marriage activity and support a marriage activity, quote unquote marriage, that they are with every cell of their body oppose. And of course the Supreme Court says now, well, that's, you know, that's a right, you know, so we'll see how far this goes for these bakers and these florists. Will they force pastors to marry gay people because it's a right? Who knows? Of course, it's not a right, and we're going to discuss that later. But it's just interesting that, you know, is this person going to get a lawsuit that because they refuse to rent a room to somebody who bashed Democrats? In their, so it's fascinating. Who knows? Okay. So, of course, the free speech issue didn't go into play there. So we're gonna go to the topic that happened in Maplewood here in their city council meeting about cameras on police officers. And I'm going to let Andrew Henderson tell the story. He went there and spoke about this issue because Police Chief Schnell made a presentation, but I want you to hear what Andrew had to say about this, and then we're going to hear one city council member's comments, which I just find disturbing. But it wasn't only just that one city council member, it was a number of them saying the same thing, and it's too bad. It's a disease, and they should know better. So let's watch what Andrew Henderson had to say. We lost the sound somehow. So if you put it on pause and then push pause, you got to put it on stop. We had this problem last night. Put it on stop and then push play again. And then the sound will come back.
Camera footage, non-public. It's all about accountability, not just for the officers, but for the people themselves. When stuff becomes non-public, it takes away from the disinfecting public light. There are things that I feel should not be public, such as, you know, victims of sexual assault, juveniles, medical calls, stuff like that. And I'm curious if any of you have ever read Minnesota Chapter 13, specifically the part on law enforcement data. I take that as a no. You have? That's a good thing. So you know that there are certain things that will not be released to the public. If there is a mental health crisis and that falls under HIPAA or a first responder type situation, that's no longer public.
So typically we don't do a Q&A, we just have you
right.
comment.
So there are things in place to prevent stuff like that from getting out. Now, my concern is things like that Minneapolis police officer that threatened to break a guy's legs, a young man's legs. Stuff like that would be considered not public under this law, or this ordinance, or whatever you want to call it. That's what concerns me. Is the little things like that. It's not the big use of force. It's the day-to-day things that I see. And I mean, often I'll see video not lining up with reports. I have seen very, very creative report writing, even on myself. Personally, body cams would have saved me a lot of trouble in the past. I think they should be on just about all the time, except for like meal times, restroom breaks, stuff like that. And that should be public. We the citizens, we deserve to know what the police are doing. And about YouTube. Stuff like, you know, going into someone's home to take a report on a burglary. That doesn't get YouTube hits. People don't watch that. That's not something that I or any of my colleagues would be interested in doing, is putting, you know, blank stuff like that out there. That doesn't matter to anybody. It's the use of force and how police officers are treating people. Another point in this I want to bring up is the what Chief Snell said about people besides the person on the film having access to this footage. Now, I work with a few organizations where we advocate for people. And sometimes we go get reports, footage, whatever, for them. Under this, it would be very hard for people to get those reports. Now, it is incredibly hard for a person that has been, you know, abused or beaten by a police officer to come in and ask for footage or a police report to that person's coworkers. So I think there definitely needs to be some kind of, you know, stipulation in that there can be something besides a court-ordered person to get the footage. So,
your 3 minutes are up.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
Okay. Councilmember.
Yeah, his 3 minutes were up. Wow, how terrible of him! He might want to go more than 3 minutes. But he raises really good points. But you know what? Now you aren't going to hear him. You got a open public meeting, public comment, and he's got something to say, but nobody else is going to comment. So you can't go more than 3 minutes, by golly. You know, if you go more than that 3 minutes, wow, you're in trouble. You know, of course that didn't show there, but you know, why don't you he was making good points. Why don't you let him finish making his points? You know, in this case, it may have seemed like he was done making his points, but he's a polite guy, you know, so maybe he had more points to make. Why do you be that way? Why do you act that way? You know, oh, you're the only one. Yeah, normally 3 minutes, but you're the only one. You know, why don't you finish? You know, we'll give you a couple more. Can you finish in a couple minutes? Oh, it might even take 10. I mean, Kathy Juneman used to take 10 minutes when she would go to public comment, you know, and now she wants to limit everybody else. See, that's a disease. That's a mental illness that Kathy Juneman has, in my opinion. Oh, I get to speak all I want, but when I go to visitors' presentation, but boy, if I get on the council, and that's not what she said. She said she'd want to speak, but when she gets on the council, she cuts it down to 3 minutes, and actually, she took it further and voted that visitors' presentations wouldn't even be seen on the video, on TV, so people couldn't see it. So this is another form of silencing thought or limiting free speech. So we got a phone call here. Caller, comment, question. Thanks for calling in.
I got a comment, Tim.
Sure.
And do you think for 1 minute that council listened to anything that man had to say at all?
No, they were looking at the clock.
Right. And they're all, you know, they just looking around the room, you know, rolling their eyes or anything else. They never hear a word that's ever said by anybody that ever gets up to that podium to talk.
And
that's the injustice of that whole council up there.
Yeah, that's right. And you know what? Mayor Slawick said, typically we don't do a question and answer. Well, you know what? They do it whenever they want to. Okay?
Right.
And they should do a question and answer during this time period. What's the harm in it?
And they should be asking a lot of questions of anybody that comes up there, and they ought to be asking a lot of questions of the staff around there. But they never do it.
Right.
It's just a rubber stamp thing is all they do.
Right.
Well, so thank you.
I agree with that. Thank you, caller. Yeah, very much so. Andrew Henderson's points about the accountability is a big issue. A disinfectant, a blue sky, as it were, letting people see what takes place. And I would say in certain situations, victims of sexual assault need to have those cameras out there. And especially if the victim says, show it, because here, this officer did this thing to me. That's what the public data is about, is usually why they want these pictures out and to see what's taking place is so that officers can be held accountable. But as Andrew Henderson said, it protects the officers from false allegations, and they get false allegations. You know, you think just the domestic violence industry deals with a ton of false allegations. Police officers deal with a ton of false allegations too, and this protects them. And of course, you have a number of police officers who loved having body cameras because they have no intent of doing anything wrong. Okay? And like Andrew Henderson said, well, I mean, he's been on my show and we've talked about it. So you can Google Speechless and Andrew Henderson and you'll find out about what happened to him and how that Ramsey County Sheriff destroyed the evidence of his video and didn't handle it through the process. And so what did she do? Retired and got another job within the Ramsey County system. It's unbelievable. And really, no criminal penalty, destroying evidence that you know is evidence, and then you remained silent all the way through a criminal prosecution of Andrew Henderson, which he got found not guilty, you know, because of the corruption that this lady, this sheriff, Ramsey County Sheriff, participated in, you know, and a body camera would have done great. But you know what? She could have turned it off. And you know what else? She could have destroyed that evidence too. You know, this is a big problem. It was interesting, Andrew Henderson went and filmed a St. Paul police officer that pulled his car all the way onto a sidewalk off the road. It was blocking a sidewalk and doing a speed trap. And Henderson approached him and say, you know, if I did this, I'd get a ticket. And the officer's going, it's okay for me to do it. You know, just a bad attitude, you know. And Andrew, my recollection, asked him, well, why do you get to do it and I don't? You know, and, you know, basically because I'm a police officer. Well, the officer, you know, was gruff with him, didn't have to be, and then later took off shortly thereafter. Videos not lining up with reports. We're seeing that, and that's getting on the news quite a bit. It's terrible that the reports are not lining up with the truth about what's going on. So the body cameras are a good thing. Oh, let's play the clip here of the next clip, number 9. And
so of doing this is that the state legislature needs some guidance. If that he does the groundwork to lay out the guidance, it's going to make it a lot easier for the legislature to deal with this in the future. So this has some real significant importance here for us to pass this and get the ball moving.
Sort of like the, you know, the Supreme Court thing. Every state passes it, right? And then eventually the Supreme Court passes certain things.
Right?
So in this case, if jurisdictions start passing it, and eventually, you know, potentially those...
But you were in the legislature. You know that it helps when you have somebody else lay the groundwork out so you can take a look what they did.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely. And that's what, you know, Senator Kent is telling me is that to be able to say for Maplewood to have this, absolutely, you're absolutely right. That lays the groundwork.
I move approval of the resolution.
All right. Very, very little discussion.
I watched the meeting.
In this.
And so I was...
very little discussion on this. And Mayor Slawik, former Representative Slawik, was in the legislature. All right. And she uses the word, the Supreme Court passes it. Okay. Supreme Court doesn't pass anything. They're not a legislative body, you know, but there again is part of the sickness that's going on in our country that thinks that this is a voting issue for the Supreme Court, and it's not. Maplewood, beware. You think you are you're going to be the cutting edge on this thing? You cannot violate people's constitutional rights. You cannot deprive them of data that protects them or prosecutes the police officer by the evidence of that camera without facing a lawsuit. So you want to be on the cutting edge. You're also going to be on the cutting edges of the lawsuits and therefore costing the taxpayers a ton of money. You have to do this to protect the taxpayer. You have to do this to protect the Constitution, is what I meant, okay? You have to protect the Constitution. So you're the government collecting data and you got the cameras. Do not put restrictions on that that violates somebody's constitutional rights. This is not a hard deal or ends up being a search without a warrant. You got a whole lot of issues going on there, and don't treat it lightly, okay? And don't try to protect their officers while denying the citizens their constitutional rights. I'm afraid that that's what's going to happen, knowing the mindset here. So it's about being on the cutting edge and leading the way. The only type of talk that goes to is denying rights, from what I see. So, with Andrew Henderson's comment being limited to 3 minutes, and there's another situation going on in Maplewood, and that is this same council, these same people, Nora Slawik, Kathleen Juniman, talking about, hey, we can't have people come up here and violate our rules. We want to force them to say things that, one, they don't have to say, like give your address. You don't have to give an address. It's in their rules. No, it's not in state law. It's not constitutional. You come up, you're having public comments, you're taking federal money. Anybody from anywhere that's a citizen of the United States can come into that meeting room and during visitors' presentation and talk. And they don't have to give their address. They may want to, but they don't have to. And for you guys to, oh, they need to give their address. You know, we tell them to and they continually don't do it. They're, you know, well, the reason you can't do anything about it is because you can't do anything about it. Okay? And you're just using this as a political game to try to make them look bad for something that's a right for them. You know, and that's, again, part of the mental illness that is going on with these council members, that they think they can force you to say something. Oh, they're going to say something that's wrong. Well, really, do you go up to this? Is this how it's going to work at the city council? Well, I got visitors' presentations here, and I want to say something. So before I say it, tell me if I can say it. And then you sit there and remain silent. Tell me if I can say it. Well, we don't know what you're going to say. Yep.
Just like when they tried to force people to say something good about Maplewood.
Oh, yeah, exactly. Remember that time? I don't know if you heard that, but there was a time when you went up to visitors' presentation. This is another Catholic gentleman. You know, she's whacked. She's whacked out, honestly. And you can watch, I mean, you see it in her behavior. This is my opinion, but here, I give you the evidence. She was trying to make people, and the city council was trying to make people say something good about the city first before you got to do your visitor's presentation. So, unbelievable. And, of course, when I went up there, I wouldn't do it. And Kathleen Juneman goes, oh, he didn't say anything positive. Well, of course not. I don't have to. And especially when you're playing that stupid game. And so now what they want you to do is go up there and ask them what you can say and say, well, is it going to be accurate if I say this? But, of course, you can't say it first to find out if it's inaccurate or accurate, because if it's inaccurate, then you shouldn't have said it. So you have to go up there and you have to say, what can I say? I mean, these people I just can't believe the insanity that's going on there. But that's what liberalism does, and you know, many people have said liberalism is a mental disorder. So who determines whether what you say is right or wrong? Well, they can believe that it's wrong, but they can't stop you from saying it. Okay? And, of course, if you've seen some people gone up there, they've gone up there and said things, and the mayor, the city council members have said, you're lying, that's not true, and every single time that a person's been proven right. But for the cameras, the city council members and the mayor grandstanding and saying, you're lying, even though they know it's the truth. Wow. How sick are they? You know, but that's part of the game, you know, that goes on. But you got to be smarter. You got to see through that. And they don't want to be held accountable for what they're doing or what they're saying, and so that's the way they attack back. And of course, the city council has all the time in the world to go and say, you know, do their council presentation and contradict anybody that they want. So what's the big deal? Have the back and forth. Just don't be a whiny, sniveling, you know, a child. You know, that it isn't getting their way or all bent out of shape because somebody said something wrong. Just correct them then, you know, and then we'll get that back and forth going on. Okay. And all of this is trying to build into our community the concept of that you do not have these freedoms to say what you want. You do not have the freedom of speech. You cannot act on your conscience, on your religious liberties, by saying what you want to say. And we're going to so overwhelm you through our own morality that we're going to try to silence you. I mean, it's the bizarrest conversation that I ever saw was that city council member. And then sometime I'll play clips, but I wanted to get to probably the most important issue that happened this week, was that there was a video that came out on abortion, of an abortion doctor selling body parts. And it's just really a tragedy. So we're going to play this video. And just the mindset and how the propaganda of abortion is so exposed and the crime that is being committed and admitted to. So let's watch this video. Someday maybe it will come up.
Now a story we guarantee most of you have never heard before. Big money is being made from the sale of fetal body parts.
Even the most ardent pro-choice advocates, like Planned Parenthood President Gloria Felt, are disturbed by what we found.
It seems inappropriate, totally inappropriate. Where there is wrongdoing, it should be prosecuted and should be brought to justice.
A lot of people want to attack parts these days because they're looking for specific nodes, AB nodes, SA. I was like, wow, I didn't even know. Good for them. Yesterday was the first time she said people wanted lungs. And then, like I said, always as many attack livers as possible. People just want.
Yeah, livers.
People want lower extremities too, which that's simple. I mean, that's easy. I don't know what they're doing with it. I guess they want muscle.
Yeah, a dime a dozen.
For the national office for all
right.
Of the affiliates. So I say, okay, what are you looking to supply today? You're very good at getting hard, long liver.
Every provider has had patients who want to donate their tissue, and they absolutely want to come. They just want to do it in a way that is not perceived as this clinic is selling tissue, this clinic is making money off of this.
Okay, so when you are, or the affiliate is determining what that is monetary.
Yes.
So that it doesn't raise any question of this is what it's about, this is the thing. What price range would you?
You know, I'm going to throw a number out. I would say it's probably anywhere from $30 to $100, depending on the facility and what's involved.
The $30 to $100 price, that's per specimen that we're talking about, right? Yeah.
Yes.
The $30 to $100 price, that's per specimen that we're talking about, right? Yeah.
Yes.
How much of a difference can that actually make if you know what kind of what's expected or what we need versus...
It makes a huge difference. I'd say a lot of people want liver.
Mm-hmm.
And for that reason, most providers put this piece under ultrasound guidance, so they'll know where they're putting their forceps. Kind of rate-limiting step of the procedure is calvarium. Calvarium, the head is basically the biggest part. Most of the other stuff can come out intact.
Right.
It's very rare to have a patient that doesn't have enough dilation to evacuate all the other
to bring the body cavity out,
exactly.
Intact and all that.
So then you're just kind of cognizant of where you put your grasp first. You try to intentionally go above and below the thorax so that, you know, we've been very good at getting hard, long liver.
Mm-hmm.
Because we know that, so I'm not going to crush that part. I'm going to basically crush below, I'm going to crush above, and I'm going to see that get out intact. And with the calvarium, in general, some people will actually try to change the presentation so that it's not vertex, so it's a vertex presentation. You never have enough dilation in the beginning unless you have a real huge amount of dilation to deliver an intact calvarium. So if you do it
starting from the breach presentation, there's dilation that happens as the case goes on, and often at the last, you can evacuate an attack. So, I mean, there are certainly steps that can be taken.
So they can convert to breach, for example,
exactly,
at the start of the...
Exactly. Under ultrasound guidance, they can just change the presentation.
Excellent.
Under ultrasound guidance, they can just change the presentation.
You could bring the body cavity out, contact all that.
So if you do it starting from the breach presentation, there's dilation that happens as the case goes on, and often the last, you can evacuate the intact cells. Federal abortion ban is a law, and laws are up to interpretation. So if I say on day one I do not intend to do this, what ultimately happens doesn't matter.
So yesterday was a clinic day. Is this for example, like, what did you procure?
You know, I asked her at the beginning of the day what she wanted. Yesterday she wanted, she's been at, a lot of people want attack parts these days because they're looking for specific nodes. AB nodes, SA. I was like, wow, I didn't even know. Good for them. Yesterday was the first time she said people wanted lungs. And then, like I said, always as many intact livers as possible. People just want
livers.
Some people want lower extremities too, which that's simple. I mean, that's easy. I don't know what they're doing with it. I guess they want muscle.
Yeah, a dime a dozen.
If you maintain enough of the dialogue to the person that's actually doing the procedures and they understand what the end game is, there are little things, changes they can make in their technique to increase your...
Even though they have a set way that they do it, they're open to changing
it. The reasonable people, sure. For example, so I had 8 cases yesterday. And I knew exactly what we needed, and I kind of looked at the list, and I said, all right, this 17-weeker has 8 clamps, and this... So I knew which were the cases that were probably more likely to yield what we needed, and I made my decisions according to that, too. So it's worth having a huddle at the beginning of the day, and that's what I do.
Rather than having to deal with all the different affiliates, if there were a way to partner with PPFA directly to get some kind of like pre-clearance or something, so that we have...
So we tried to do this. And at the national office, we have a litigation and law department, which just really doesn't want us to be the middle people on this issue right now. Because we were approached by Stem Express to do the same thing. One of the Northern California affiliates said, we're working with this, people love it. Every affiliate should work with them. And so we had a conversation, and we said, you know, what do you think? We'll just go out and find all the people that are doing this and present everybody with a menu, and they, at the end of the day, they just decided it's, right now it's too touchy an issue for us to be an official middleman. But that,
when you say right now, do they see a future?
Right now, the way the Supreme Court looks, I don't think it looks very good.
Okay.
If you talk to my litigation and law folks, anything that's going to go to the Supreme Court right now, we're all losers. But I will tell you that behind closed doors, these conversations are happening with the affiliates.
Cecile, thank you so much for Dr. Nuka Pola. She's been so helpful for the past couple years. I'm with fetal tissue collection.
I know a lot of
she's
you do it.
Very, very helpful with the team to talk to you and how to, like...
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you for that.
Thank you.
Thanks
for being here.
Wow. Planned Parenthood's response that I understand was that abortion's legal, and it is. It's not illegal to commit an abortion. It is heinous, and especially when they're doing But many of these things are illegal. Partial birth abortion. If a baby's coming out whole, you got to try to save its life. So they're doing partial birth abortion at an earlier time, delivering it the same way in order to harvest certain body parts. Of course, it's illegal to harvest body parts, and selling human body parts is illegal. Donating them is not, and that's where this $30 to $100 per specimen came into place. And Planned Parenthood's discussion, well, this is shipping costs. Well, the problem with that is that's not what she said. I'm sure the shipping cost is on top of that, because how do you, because it was a per specimen, you know, and you could probably fit 10 specimens and get your $30 shipping costs, or it could be one and it could be $30 shipping costs, you know, so that's just baloney. So they're charging for these body parts, lungs, livers, hearts. And I want to thank Center for Medical Progress.org that put this together. It's interesting how they expose what Planned Parenthood's philosophy and mindset is on this, and that they really don't want this to be known. They didn't want it to be known. They've been doing this. And so it's good that Congress is going to look into this. But see, this is part of the devaluation of humans. We did it to blacks. We did it. What I mean by that is certain people in the United States did that to blacks. But nationalities and ethnic groups have done this to other nationalities and ethnic groups since forever. But it's dehumanizing the other group. But some groups are out there doing bad things. And when good people stop the bad stuff, that's a good thing. And sometimes you have to stop bad behavior. Well, you should stop it as often as you can. And Planned Parenthood, who sees these babies, they admit they're babies. There's nobody in Planned Parenthood that admits that they're blobs. They call them blobs or fetuses, but they all know they're babies. They're just playing off your ignorance, but they don't care that they're babies. Why should they care that they're babies? This is just an unbelievable video. And this is part of the exposing and, of course, hanging a black person, had to be exposed too. And once people saw the torture, the torment that was done, that got people to rise up and actually do something about it. But the question comes in, well, I'm going to add another, tie in another issue here with, you know, at least Gloria Phelps said that anything illegal should be dealt with, you know, pro-abortionist, you know, should be dealt with. And the cry for the abortionist is the moral outcry is that women should have the right to choose. That's the highest value. That's the morality that's established. This is our legislative morality. Women have the right to choose. It doesn't matter what they do to who, to another life. We know it's a life. We know it's a baby. But it doesn't matter, because the most important thing is that women have the right to choose. And so that ends up being the morality that's legislated as of right now. And I'm going to quote another person, and you'd be surprised at who they are and what they believe. And this gets us into the realm of homosexuality. This person said, "Homosexuality is not normal. On the contrary, it is a challenge to the norm. Nature exists whether academics like it or not." Of course, if you go to the St. Paul School Board and you point out to them that nature exists, and you may call yourself a girl, but you're really a boy because every cell in your body says you're a male, you know, nature exists whether academics like it or not. So St. Paul School Board, you know, you're crazy, okay? And in nature, procreation is the single relentless rule. That is the norm. Our sexual bodies were designed for reproduction. No one is born gay. The idea is ridiculous. Homosexuality is not an adaptation. This is important here. The person that said this is a lesbian activist, Camille Paglia. And what's important here is she knows the truth. She understands the truth. The abortions know the truth. They understand the truth. They don't care because there's a higher value. And what is that higher value? It's what we want to do. Don't care what the consequences are, not only to ourselves, but to other people, because it's what I want to do. And doesn't, so what we have now is the gay marriage, the homosexual marriage being approved by our U.S. Supreme Court, and all of a sudden, amorality is being legislated upon us. And so here's a morality I want us to think about. Should crushing a baby above the heart and below the stomach, should that be a morality that should be legislated and saying, no, this is wrong? You know, clearly, they're describing a fully formed human body. There's no question about it. Above the heart, below the stomach, in order to save the liver, the lungs, the intestines, the heart. They're making a decision based on the body parts of that which is a human and fully formed. Formed. In the process of being formed, because guess what? You as a human after birth are not fully formed. Girls aren't fully formed until they become women. Are they fully a girl? Girl? Yeah. Is a baby fully a baby? Yeah. Okay, so should that be a legislated morality? Our legislated morality right now says, no, it's okay, kill the human, no problem. Okay, should we legislate morality? That's something that gets talked about all the time. There's a good article here by Doug Gruthius. He's a professor of philosophy at Denver Seminary, Christian Seminary in Dallas, or excuse me, in Denver. Is there a Denver Seminary in Dallas? I don't think so. Play that on the bloopers. Okay, the highlights. I like what this guy has to say because he's really hitting it hard with these fake pastors or want-to-get-along pastors and say these things. We can't legislate morality. Well, all legislation is based on a morality. And American civil law ought to be rooted in a consistent, rooted in and consistent with the Constitution, which itself is based on a philosophy of natural law or natural rights. That is, there is a law above the law to which the law should conform as much as possible in a fallen world. This powerful idea is found in the Declaration of Independence. Of course, we went against that in the recent Supreme Court ruling. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. They are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable, I like to say unalienable, rights. You can't put a lien against these rights. That among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the government, from the consent of the governed. Governments are instituted to secure rights given by the Creator. Governments do not create rights. And that's just what our Supreme Court has been doing, creating these rights that aren't rights. You don't have the right to kill another human being, but our government says you do. You don't have the right to say that, to redefine marriage, but our Supreme Court says you do. Governments do not create rights by their dicta. All right, well, all law is based on a morality. All right, we're done. Sorry. We'll have to cover that some more time later. Remember, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week.
You said to me that you wouldn't leave, but now I see that you're lost. Sets on fire.